So 2 weeks ago, our brother Bill started us in a very fine study in the book of 1 Thessalonians. It's a book written to a group of people in a major city who were trying to be believers, having come from an ungodly life. That city was not a godly city, and they were trying to live as effective Christians in a non-Christian world. For that reason, since each of us here are doing the same thing, that's a very profitable study. Last week, Bill chose to speak his entire time on one word that's in the introduction. He spoke about the words and the desire of the writer when he said, "I wish to you grace and peace." Now, it's not chance that the book of 1 Thessalonians starts with that phrase, "grace and peace to you." In fact, that book was written by the Apostle Paul. He wrote a significant percentage or portion of the New Testament. Every book he writes, every book without exception, starts with that phrase, "I wish to you grace and peace." Sometimes he'll add mercy or something else, but grace is always there. And he ends with the same thought at the end of every book. And then there's another book that makes 18 books in the New Testament that at least close with that concept. So, the grace of God. The Apostle Paul, the man who Jesus personally appeared to after he'd already left the earth, he comes back to enlist Paul in his service. Apostle Paul, the man who wrote the majority of the New Testament that we rely on. Apostle Paul, the man who says that he doesn't know if he was in his mind or in his body, but he was in heaven and God gave him a tour of the place. He had seen the residence and the home of God and the place he would be, and it changed his life in an irreparable way forever. That man is the man we're talking about who is completely concerned and no doubt would have told you that it was a key attribute, if not the key attribute, of the very nature of God, His grace. So for that reason, we're going to spend a little more time on that concept today. Hopefully it will be helpful to us as then the fellowship moves forward with Bill's leadership into the continued study of 1 Thessalonians, all for the purpose of helping us, like those people back there, be more effective as we live for Christ in an un-Christ world. So, why do we even care about grace? Why is grace such a big deal? Well, I submit it's for three reasons. Number one, it comes from God. It's not available from any other place. Number two, our eternity depends on it. And number three, we find in grace an encapsulated display of the nature of God Himself. That's important. I would suggest that God has a personality, all beings do, and that at least three major components of God's personality are love, mercy, and a desire for relationship. Those three traits combined together explain much about God Himself and explain why we have grace. Grace, like many important aspects of life, is intangible. That makes it harder to grasp. You can't go down to the store and buy 6 pounds of it. You can't get it in a package. You can't order it on Amazon. It just comes in a way that you can't control. It has to be dispensed to you by God. One commentator wrote about grace in this way. He says, "A rigid definition is hardly possible, but still a single conception is actually present in almost every case where grace is found. The conception that all a Christian has or is centered exclusively in God and Christ and depends utterly on God through Christ." So did you catch that? He's saying that in the realm of Christianity, that's the realm where we live, the realm where the concept of my salvation in eternity is through Jesus. That entire realm, that entire process is founded exclusively on God and His goodwill to us. God and Christ, as you already know, hold all power. They hold all the cards in the game of eternity. And when we come to deal with God and Christ on where we will be forever, we have no cards to play. We have no chips to put on the table. We have no negotiating leverage because we come in a sinful position. We come powerless to change what happens the moment our eyes close in death, and we're completely relying on them. So the grace, the goodwill that they give us is obviously paramount importance. But lucky for us, God's personality, the love and mercy and desire for relationship that He encompasses brings us to grace. Now, you know about grace already, so you probably won't learn a thing today. But hopefully it will be a useful few minutes as you at least reflect on it and how it will apply to you. Grace is talked about constantly through the Bible, more in the New Testament, but likely the most clear and obvious text about it is in Ephesians 2. And you've heard it before, but I would encourage you to sort of wipe that slate clean and focus on it just for a moment as we put it on the screen here, and let's focus on what it's saying about us and God and grace. Verse 4, Ephesians 2. But God is so rich in mercy, and He loved us so much that even though we were dead because of our sins, He gave us life when He raised Christ from the dead. It is only by God's grace that you have been saved. For He raised us from the dead along with Christ and seated us with Him in the heavenly realms because we are united with Christ Jesus. So, God can point to us in all future ages as examples of the incredible wealth of His grace and kindness towards us, as shown in all He has done for us who are united with Christ Jesus. Let's don't miss this sentence. God saved you by His grace when you believed. And you can't take credit for this. It's a gift from God. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we've done. Let's go over that again. Salvation is not a reward for the good things we've done, so none of us can boast about it. Wow. A gift from God. That's grace. Seems to me that the entire Bible is trying to communicate a few specific messages to us. Powerful messages. Those messages, in my opinion, my observation, are primarily about the nature and the personality of God and His deep desire to have a direct and intimate relationship with every one of us. Now, He's God. He could have anything He wants, but that seems to be what He chooses. In summary, the personality of God is warm and kind and gracious and merciful, benevolent. He even refers to Himself as a friend at the time He had relations and discussions with Moses. That's the type of relationship that He wants to have. But He's also fair, powerful, just, and incapable of accepting sin. So that forces Him from time to time to take certain actions. God picked out a word to describe Himself. You already know the word, but let's review briefly what words He didn't choose. Now, just for fun, pretend that you're God. Some of you don't have much trouble with that. I know I don't. So, you think about yourself and you look at the universe you created and you look at the environment that you have and you look at all the powers you have and all that you know, and there is nobody like you. And so then you say, well, what's a good word to describe me? Should it be all-knowing? Well, it could be, but I won't say that. Should it be all-powerful? Well, it could be, but I won't say that. Should it be omnipotent because I'm everywhere all the time? Well, it could be, but I won't say that. How about master of the universe? How about the boss of everything, including you? Wouldn't all those work for God? You know what He chooses? He chooses, say it with me, love. John 4, 1 John 4, verse 8. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. Same chapter, verse 16. And so we know and rely on the love of God has for us. God is love. I think it's very significant that if you have unlimited power and unlimited control and unlimited access to everything and nothing can hinder you in any way, you choose to be love. And that's where we are. Because of that core trait and his fondness for the human race, his deepest desire, it seems, then is to be in direct contact with each of us, all 6 billion of us who live on the earth. And yet, sadly, as God looks down on the world, he sees just a minute fraction of the population, people like us in this room, who even think about him casually and occasionally. I suspect that's disappointing to God. The Bible shows clearly that God is intent on having a relationship. It starts with the earliest chapters of Genesis. You know the story. He makes the world. Working through Jesus Christ, they create everything there is. They pick a part over there in the Middle East and they upgrade it to paradise level. They put human beings in it, the only creatures that are made in their own image. And they make it perfect. They give them a special fruit so they can live for eternity and never be sick or ill or annoyed in any way. And they say, we'll drop by every day or two and we'll visit. And Adam and Eve said, well, let's see if we can find something better than this. Isn't that sad? God knew as he was setting it up that it wouldn't last, that humanity would break it. And sure enough, we did. When they had a choice, they chose their own personal needs and desires and judgment over the will and obedience to God. And then God spends the next 40 centuries, literally, building through the process that he'd already designed to lead to Jesus Christ and the process of forgiveness and sanctification, the process that we are relying on, the salvation that's available to us through God's kindness and grace because of our faith in Jesus Christ. That's the process. But God's point of view, his desire, his want to have that relationship never changed. And through the story of the Old Testament, we see him continually working on that with the human race. Remarkable. Eternal perfection, totally undeserved, unearned salvation is what God wants to give us. That's what grace is. That's what's composed in that little phrase at the beginning of every letter Paul wrote, grace to you. Now that's some pretty good news, and you guys look pretty somber. I mean it. That really is good news. God has done this for us, and every morning when you get up, that's where we are. So that's cause for some joy. That's why Paul and the other writers in the New Testament can say, give joy always. Rejoice in every circumstance, even when your immediate difficulty may be all you can think about. The truth of your future is there for you because of the grace of God. Now, I have a hunch that sometimes over this long period of time in the Old Testament where God is working through all this to reclaim humanity back to himself, that it was frustrating. It would have had to been. And we see evidences in the Old Testament where God is frustrated. He once says to Moses, you remember the story? Okay, stand back. I'm just going to kill them all and we'll start with you again. Now, that's a paraphrase, but he actually said it. And Moses says, well, let's rethink this. Let's don't do it. Now, I don't think God really intended to do that. But the point is, yes, it was frustrating to him how we as humans are so frequently not accepting and responsive to God. But he has given us the choice, and that's the choice that is often made. Even so, the entire Old Testament is this continued story of God's work to arrange all the circumstances of history, to keep a group of people intact, the Jews, so he could lead forward and teach them all the things they needed to know, so when Jesus came, it would at least make sense, and there would be a framework for it. And that's what we see God doing. It was a complex process because many spiritual concepts are involved. This whole process from creation to the birth of Jesus is roughly a 4,000-year period. And even a casual studier of the Old Testament will see that as we go through there, God tries to educate the human race about sin and how it can't exist with God, about the penalty for sin being death, about the power of evil and how it works, about Satan and what he does. And all through this process, he's working through the Jews, a special nation of people where he can try to get them further up the ladder on that. Sometimes they're successful and sometimes they're not. But it was God's continual effort to get to the point where we are today, so we can deal with him not through law, but through grace. And that's another reason we should always be smiling. No one could keep the law with 500 and something specific rules, but we can all accept the grace of God. God consistently provided this kindness and grace all through the Old Testament to many people who were willing to work with Him. If you were willing to be obedient, that's really all God cared about. Think about Noah. Think about Moses. Think about Joseph. Think about Abraham. Think about Isaac. Think about all these men and women who were faithful and who God worked with and showed kindness. But more often, the large majority of mankind ignored God, and they chose to do wrong. And we know that part of the nature of God is He can't abide with sin. So we see things in the Old Testament, for example, when you get to the time of Noah, do you remember what the Bible says about humanity? The paraphrase is, basically, and it's pretty close, every thought and intent of the heart of every person was evil all the time. Go back and check me up on that. Not right now. But that's a pretty dramatic statement. But Noah found grace. He finds one man, and so he saves that one man, and from that we do start again. But when things get so bad, God has to take action because He cannot coexist with evil. Fast forward many hundreds of years, and He's bringing the Israelites to the land of Palestine, and He made them wait another several hundred years, and He explains why in the New Testament. He says, I wanted to give all those people in the Palestinian place all the time they needed to get as wicked as they possibly could in their rank idolatry. And no doubt He was giving them opportunities to repent. But when they had finally proven they would not, He brings in the Israelites and He says, okay, we're wiping out this idolatrous, godless race that is a blight on the world, and you will live here now. And yet, I go through those two stories because as you discuss God with people in your lives, you will come across people who point to those events and say, well, that's proof that this God you like is just harsh and cruel and rude, and I could never have anything to do with a God like that. That gives you a talking point. That gives you a place to start. No, that's the very God you want. And you can explain why God has to do that and the way around that. And it's the process. The nature of God doesn't change. So all through the Old Testament, people were struggling with these concepts of physical versus spiritual, evil versus sin, the immediate things I need to deal with, what God wants me to do, which is very long term. Should I worship this idol or go down to that synagogue with those people? All these things that the human race had to deal with, and it was complicated for them. So God tried to simplify it. He would use analogies to help people understand the type of relationship He wanted to have. The two relationships that He would describe most often were that of a father and that of a husband. And there are many texts that we could look at. We'll just look at a few. Jeremiah 31 is a typical text. It says, we read these two texts about fatherhood. See if you hear any emotion in these words. Is not Ephraim my dear son? Ephraim was his nickname for the nation of Israel. The child in whom I delight? Though I often speak against him, I still remember him. Therefore, my heart yearns for him. I have great compassion for him, declares the Lord. Another text about the fatherhood image that God's trying to purvey to His people is in Hosea. Now, if you've never read the book of Hosea or it's been a long time, I recommend you take 45 minutes or an hour and read it. It is a remarkable story, and it's all about God trying to illustrate the unfaithfulness of His people to a God who's trying so much to care for them. Hosea 11, verse 1. When Israel was a child, I loved him, and out of Egypt I called my son. But the more they were called, the more they went away from me. They sacrificed to the Baals, and they burned incense to images. It was I who taught Ephraim to walk. You see that vision? Have you ever held a little child's hands as they're just trying to walk? God did that to this nation, taking them by the arms, but they did not realize it was I who healed them. I led them with cords of human kindness, with ties of love. To them I was like one who lifts a little child to the cheek, and I bent down to feed them. It seems to me as we read these two texts that we hear emotion and longing in the voice of God. We hear desire to care for these people and to be involved with them, and they're not overly responsive. Bill mentioned last week a story that we know very well, the story of the prodigal son. You know about this son. I would suggest to you that one of the major points we should get from that story is not the behavior of the son, but just give thanks for the behavior of the father. The son comes along and he says, well, I'm a grown-up now and I don't like living here, and give me my stuff now, I'm out of here. And the father could have said, well, I don't think so, but he does. He takes half of his wealth, which was no doubt quite a bit, and he gives it to this young man, knowing he probably won't do well with it. The young man goes and does every conceivable bad thing with it and wastes a lifetime worth of accumulation of wealth that's been given to him. When he finally is completely without any hope or care, he comes to himself and he says, well, at least I wouldn't starve if I was a slave in my dad's house. I'll go back there. So he goes back. You know the story. How did he look? He didn't have any money for a motel or new clothes or a shower. You know he looked and smelled bad. He'd walked by foot, and he's a mess. Meanwhile, the father, this wealthy man with an established home and another son and a place of position in his community, what's the father doing all this time? He's not going to the Rotary Club. He's not building his wealth back. He is looking. He is investing his time in longing for this bad son who's gone away. And the moment he sees him way down the road, and he didn't know he was coming today, what does he do? He says, well, I better get ready. This is going to be a scene. So he goes to the mirror, and he ties his tie right, and he makes sure his coat's straight, and he gets a real somber look. Is that what he does? No. He picks up his robe, and this grown older fellow goes running down the road, and when he gets to the stinky, dirty, no good son, he grabs him, and he kisses his face, and he sobs. And he's crying, I'm so glad you're here. Now that's our Father. That's grace in action. And that's why we need to be smiling. That's why we need to be glad that Paul reminds us in every letter, grace to you, because it's there. The God that we're serving is all about coming and grasping you and having that relationship. Another analogy that God uses a great deal in the Old Testament is that of a husband. Isaiah 54, Jeremiah 3:14, Jeremiah 3:20, Hosea 2:16. We could give you more. Let's just look at Jeremiah 3:20 on the slide if you could. Jeremiah 3:20. But like a woman unfaithful to her husband, so you, Israel, have been unfaithful to me, says the Lord. Trying to get that relationship concept explained to them. Marriage is a very close union of two persons, sharing every aspect of life. And that's what God wants to portray. Now, what do we see in common here for a parent, a father, and a husband? They're both positions where they're based on love, they're based on respect, they're based on care and providing what's needed and giving protection and having a sharing of emotion. Those are some of the traits that God is trying to call us to when He is extending us grace. So God wants that relationship based on love, and we get to respond. Now, parenting, the one about being the father, that makes sense, doesn't it? How many of you are parents? Many of you. How about over here? How many of you aren't willing to raise your hand? Linda and I are parents. We have three terrific kids and five grandchildren. I've mentioned before that all the grandchildren are exceptional, but no one ever asked me about that. Anyway, our son and his family had always lived in Medford, literally, as long as they've been married. 2 days before New Year's, this last New Year's, they got in their truck and they drove away to Memphis to move. Now, do you know how far it is to Memphis? It is 2,400 miles approximately. That is 200 dozens of miles. It's very far. Okay, there were all kinds of reasons for this move. Economically, it was better. Educationally, it was better. They have a couple special needs in their family. There were some family members there who had needs and situations. It was much better for my son's work day. We'll get into all the details. It was a very positive, sound, logical thing for him as the father to take care of his family to do. And I and my wife thought it was the worst idea ever conceived in human society. We mentioned that. We could go on and on with this, but we won't. Here's the point of my story. The day before it was time to leave, it was disclosed that, well, the trailer you were going to trail your van on, that's going to be hooked to the longest, biggest U-Haul truck that they've got, and inside this truck you're going to have two grade school boys, and inside the van you're going to have a 90-pound dog. All that was the process my son was going to go 2,400 miles with by himself, and the trailer wouldn't work, and this and that, and now there is no way for him to do this alone. And he's supposed to leave early the next morning because he has to be there at a certain time to begin the job and this and that. And guess who helps drive to Memphis? You got it right. There is no prize. Now, let me just tell you, from my point of view, that was unmerited favor. Is that not the definition of grace? Unmerited favor. That's what we've always heard. But seriously, it was, I thought, and I thought, well, this is what God does for us. No part of me wanted to help him go there and make that one-way trip. But it was good for him, and it was a right decision, and it was what he needed, and it was what my son had to have help on to accomplish what he needed to do, someone I loved and cared for and was responsible for and had said I would assist, had a need, and so it's my role as a father to help him with that, right? That's what God's trying to communicate to us. That's his message. And he does it a whole lot better than I did. He does not have a bad attitude about it. But you see the point there. I encourage each of us to think of God in that level of emotion that we think of our own children, because he's done all he can to convince us that that's where he is. And to me, that's powerful. They're doing well in Memphis. God's our dad, and we're his children. We know how good God is. We know the needs he has provided for us. So why then, as we go along in life, do we sometimes find ourselves resisting God? We will not have a show of hands on that. Why do we do that, though? Why are we not always anxious to do what God wants? Well, because sometimes it's hard, and sometimes it's difficult, and sometimes we'd rather do something else. We make poor choices. God doesn't change, but we always get to decide how we'll act. Jesus gives us some help on that. He says in Matthew 11:25, Jesus said, "I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and learned and revealed them to little children." Matthew 18:3, and he said, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Matthew 19:14, Jesus said, "Let the little children come to me, and do not hinder them, for the kingdom of heaven belongs to such as these." Let's go back to 18:3, brother. "Unless you change and become like a little child, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven." Now, that doesn't make any sense at all, does it? Because little children do the dumbest things. They can't take care of themselves, and they'll eat candy every meal, and they just go on and on, right? So why is Jesus advising us to be little children? He is talking about the attitude of acceptance and obedience and love and openness. That's my opinion. And I know this because last weekend, this is a true story, my grandson Max gave me a lesson on this. Max is 4 years old, so he is a well-taught theologian in this topic. Max and his two-year-old sister Sloan were spending 3 nights at our house because the parents had to go. It was a family matter, a very serious health matter in my son-in-law's family, so they were away. So it's bedtime on the second day, and we're doing the pajama, toothbrush, read the story thing. We're in the bathroom about to do the toothbrushing. And all afternoon, a major topic much time, much discussion had been about Legos. You know about Legos? Every aspect of Legos had been investigated, explained, detail work, particularly Ninja Legos, which are a passion. That had been the thought, that had been the concept, various aspects, and we would go to other topics, but we would come back. That's continuing as we go into the bathroom, and all at once there's a pause, and he looks at me and he says, "Papa, you know that my dada is very strong and good." Blanket statement of fact. Nothing to do with Legos. I said, "Well, yes, he is." And he said, "Right." And there was a pause, and he didn't say much, and he looked at me up again, and he says, "You know, Papa, my dada loves me." And I said, "Well, yes, Mac, he does." And all this time, I'm trying to move along and get the toothbrush and the paste. And so he's working with me on that, and we make a few strokes, and he looks up and he says, "I miss him when I am gone." You catch those words? "I miss him when I am gone." And I didn't say anything. I'm just listening. A couple more strokes, and then he stops again, and he gets this really sad look, and he kind of glances up, and he says, "I can't do it justice. I need to be with him." And I said, "Well, I understand that." And we moved on. We talked about that just a little bit. And I said, "So, Dada is pretty important, right?" He said, "Yep." I said, "Do you remember something Dada always tells you?" And his face changed. He says, "Yes, Mama and Dada always come back." Because that's a core truth they have taught him when they have to be away. And he struggles with that when he's alone. Mama and Dada always come back. And once he got that, coupled with what he knew about his dad, he was fine. And we went on, the loneliness was passed, and Papa and Mima were okay for the next day or so until they came back. That's what Jesus, I think, is talking about. Does that make sense? That's the level of core acceptance. My dada is big and strong, and he loves me. He got it. But he got it in the emotional place where he makes decisions of life. And that's what God's trying to get us to do. Not intellectual knowledge, but real knowledge. So, the heart of a child who truly trusts God is what God wants us to have. And in return, God's going to do what he says in Ephesians 1, verse 7. "In accordance with the riches of God's grace that he," say that word with me, "lavished." I just love that word. "Grace that he lavished on us with all wisdom and understanding." When you lavish something, what do? You just wastefully pour out way too much of it and give it to everybody, right? That's what God's saying. He doesn't dole it out 2 grams at a time. It's like a tidal wave if we're willing to stand up there and accept it. God wants to lavish his good on us. He truly cares. So why don't we long for God in return like Max longed for his dada? Well, to understand that, we'd have to know why there's evil in the world and why humans are attracted to sin and all of these issues. And we may never understand that because we're human and we're not perfect yet. But we can know that even if we don't understand our behavior sometimes, we can still control it. And the one thing we have to do is to grasp and retain the grace of God. Does that make sense? Would you say that with me? I have to grasp and retain the grace of God. Oh, such conviction you had. You want to try that again, or you want to just slink away in embarrassment? One more time. I want to grasp and retain the grace of God. You even smile. That's awesome. Okay. You can take that to the bank. Your salvation, my eternity, our eternal future depends on 2 things. God extending his grace to us, and he's going to do that. Secondly, us accepting it, right? You can have all kinds of stuff lavished on you, but if you refuse to open your arms and accept it, it won't do you any good. God has done everything He can to get us to the place of eternity. It starts in Genesis, where He makes perfection and starts the process. It ends in Revelation. 4,000 years later, everything is done. Jesus says, "Behold, I stand at the door and what? Knock." And when we hear that, we have to decide, am I going to get up and run across the room and throw open the door and grab that being and hold him and not let him escape because he's the fix to every problem I have? Or are we going to turn the other way and flip the music a little louder and go on with whatever it is we're doing? We get to choose over and over. Grace is the core of our hope. We're no different in that way than the people throughout the Old Testament where they had to choose. God set up the Jews. You remember that? He started them simple. I'll give you 10 specific rules. We call them the 10 commandments. Our society would view them as the 10 suggestions. The 10 commandments. The first two were pretty clear. You shall have no other gods before me. That means God's number one. Two, you shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above or on earth beneath or in the waters below. So God's first, and no images or anything else to worship instead of God. Would you agree with that? That's what those mean? Well, I got to tell you, the Jews were complete failures at trying to do that. For hundreds of years, no, thousands of years, they would try for a little while and they would fail, and everything in the world would get in the way, and they would always choose bowing down before a stick or a rock or whatever and doing something horrible in the name of religion rather than God, who was fixing all their problems. And it's interesting to me that when we go to study 1 Thessalonians, these are people who live in a town that is devoted to idol worship. And they're people who were formerly idolaters, and now they're trying to live as Christians, and it's a struggle for them. And we read that, and we think, oh, those poor people, who would ever bow down before a piece of wood? And that's just dumb. Idolatry doesn't relate to us. We don't do that. But we do work 80 hours a week so we can get ahead, maybe several years in a row, maybe 15 years in a row, still doing it. I don't know. We will scrimp and save and do some pretty extreme things so we can get a big pile of money so we can be absolutely sure that when I get old, I'll be safe because there's no other way I can have my needs met. Now, I help people with investment counseling, so obviously I'm not opposed to that. But if it becomes a god, it's an issue, right? Sometimes we get so attached to something specific, and we have to have it so badly that it takes over everything, and it's more important than anything. It could be sex, it could be drugs, it could be alcohol, it could be food, it could be money, it could be security, it could be control, it could be any number of things that have come to take the place of God in our lives. And if that's what we put first and then God comes in later, guess what we are? We have become to think like an idolater. So my point is this, as near as I can tell, human nature hasn't changed much since the beginning of the world. Technology changes and knowledge changes and understanding of science changes, but I don't think the human personality and the emotional structures of people have changed, and we still do kind of the same things. So we probably better pay attention to 1 Thessalonians. As they figure out how to move from their old culture to their new, as they try to figure out how to incorporate the grace of God. All of us have probably served the wrong gods in the past. Maybe we will again, at least for a moment or two. But we've always got to remember that Jesus is standing at the door and knocking. Jesus is hoping we'll open the door and let him in. And we can make that decision every time. And even if we've kept the door slammed for a day or a month or a year or a decade, God is still the father of the prodigal waiting for us to come back. And we should not wait a moment. We need to come back and know that he will be there with his grace. We serve an amazing God. and the grace is there everywhere. Grace is the best thing we have going for us. That's why we think about it. That's why it's in every book that Paul wrote. That's why we talk about it. That's why it's a religious word that we use. But it's a real life thing that we count on. There's even a great song about it. Who knows the song, Amazing Grace? Okay, if everybody doesn't raise their hand, your seat will drop and you'll fall on the floor. Powerful song. You know how old that song is? It's almost 250 years old. It was written by a man named John Newton in 1772. He wrote the words. And then later on, the tune got replaced, and it's been famous for a long time. It's powerful in part because of the story of John Newton. John Newton started life as a little boy. He had a mother who loved him and a father who was a ship captain. His father was a slave trader, gone most of the time. The mother was a wonderful mother and taught him about God and how to sing and all kinds of things. And she died when he was 7 years old. The father then remarries almost immediately to a lady from another country. They move away. I don't know if Newton went with him or not, but he didn't have much parentage after that. He's a very small boy. He starts working on ships. This wasn't uncommon in that day. Grows up. By the time he's 20 years old, he is such an ill-tempered, ill-mannered, reprobate kind of a guy that when they're in Africa looking for more slaves to buy and take them to sell, his own shipmates turn him over to one of the African leaders and leave him there, and he's enslaved by the Africans for a year. Now, I don't know how much this is true or false, but it's one recount of his life that I read. He says after he escaped, he really got bad at that point and lived a horrible life for years. He's still serving as a sailor years later, and he's on a ship, and it's just about to sink, and he has sort of a where he should have died, and he's saved. And he said, at that moment, it dawned on me that God had intervened, and he began to change his life, and he pointed to that day as the day he changed and became a believer in God. He goes up forward, although he finally becomes a ship captain and is a slave trader himself. He eventually gives that up and finally becomes an Anglican pastor. Years later, in that role, he's writing a sermon on a particular day that deals with God's wonderful treatment of King David. Grace is the concept that he had, and he thought, I wish I had a song to talk about this concept. And he thought about it, and he reflected on his life and how bad he had been and how he was now able to be in the good graces of God, and this song is the result. Hundreds of years later, it's still well known. Because of the topic and because of how well it accomplishes the issues and the power of God's grace. It's been used many times in our own day. It was used often in the civil rights movement. It was sung supposedly at the service where Martin Luther King delivered his famous I Have a Dream speech. It was sung at the event where Martin Mandela was released from South African prison after so many years. It was sung at a ceremony when the Berlin Wall collapsed. It was sung at the 9/11 tragedy, which rocked our nation, in a ceremony for that. It's been sung countless times in worship centers. It's a meaningful hymn because of its message. How amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. John 14, 23 says, in the words of Jesus, anyone who loves me will obey my teaching. My Father will love them, and we will come to them and make our home with them. If we're willing to accept this grace of God, God Himself and our Savior Jesus Christ, if these words are true, will come and live with us. That's what amazing grace means. If you're willing, let's sing this song. And if you're willing, I encourage you to sing it with the meaning it has to you in your heart. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. was blind, but now I see. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Through many dangers, toils, and snares, we have already come. 'Twas grace that brought us safe thus far, and grace will lead us home. Well done. I pray that each of us will have the grace of God. Thank you so much for joining us at Table Rock today. Hope you go and have a blessed day. There will be people in the corner here to pray with you. They're really good at it. If you have questions or concerns, you want to speak to a pastor, there'll be someone up here. And please take a minute to show grace as you're leaving to someone else. Thank you.